Right. So as I said, the outline for today is was this first part about the logistic, the organization of the course. Then now, for maybe 1 hour or so, I will try to motivate and give you an introduction to deep learning. And then in the second part for this morning, we'll cover some fundamentals, some of the things you have learned already if you follow Introduction to Machine Learning by Pierre Gerst and Louis Wenkel. It should be fresh because it was only a few weeks ago that you had to present the exam for this course. But I think still it's a good it's good to do to cover again a few of the elements that you have seen in this course. All right. So the outline for the entire course will be as follows. So today we'll have the introduction and these fundamentals. Then next week we'll see our very first neural network, which is known as the multi-layer perceptron, really the building block of modern deep learning. And then the week after, in lecture three, we'll talk about automatic differentiation. So really the mathematical formalism to express algorithms for automatic differentiation, including algorithms like backpropagation. Then in lecture four, I will cover training algorithms or optimization algorithms for training neural networks. You will see that there are many different ways, many different algorithms that you can use to train the kind of model we'll be talking about. Then in the following lecture, we'll start considering more concrete applications. And so the first one will be to try to apply neural networks to spatially structured data like images. And the very first class of network we'll see are convolutional neural networks for this purpose. Then we'll see how to go beyond simple regression and classification problem. So I will have a lecture on computer vision in which we'll talk about how to do object detection, segmentation, and this kind of task. Then we'll move on to recurrent neural networks, which are neural networks that are able to maintain a state and then to process sequences. Then after that, we'll have, and this is a new lecture, lecture eight, a follow-up lecture on attention and transformer networks. So transformer networks are actually quite recent. They are only 2 or 3 years old, but they are becoming really dominant in the deep learning literature. So I think it's quite important to cover them now. We'll have two lectures on generative models. So these kind of neural networks are ne neural networks that you can use to model probability distributions or simply samplers. So you can use the model to generate data. So it could be simply tabular data, but it could be more complicated data like images, sound, and so on. So we'll see algorithms like GANs, VAEs, and these kind of models. Finally, in lecture 11, I will talk about uncertainty in Bayesian deep learning, and so how to take into account the different type of uncertainty you may have. And finally, if we have time, but it should be okay, I will have a final lecture on deep reinforcement learning. Right, so that's the program for this year. We have quite a lot to cover, but I think it will be quite interesting for you. The way it's also organized, if you want to have an overview of how all these topics connect to one another, is what I've try to represent on this map. So you have a common chunk of five lectures from lecture zero to lecture four, which are really about the fundamentals of neural networks. So MLPs, multi-layer perceptrons, automatic differentiation, and then training. And this is also the foundations that we want you, that we'll try to make you practice during the homeworks. And then you have more exciting applications. So on the left, it's more You could categorize that as everything related to images, so convolutional neural networks and computer vision. In orange, everything related to sequences, and that could be, for example, text, like recurrent neural networks, attention and transformer networks. And then on the right, in red, everything related to probabilistic modeling, generative models, and these kind of things, right? And so in the project, you will have the opportunity to choose among all these things what you want to explore more and to try to understand better. So that will be your choice. And then finally, also, there is the deep reinforcement learning lecture, which is a bit disconnected from the outline from the other lectures, but I think it's still quite important. So for those of you who have followed my course on Introduction to AI, I think it's a nice complement. It will be a nice complement to see how you can do reinforcement learning, how you can combine deep learning with reinforcement learning. All right, so my mission will be that by the end of this course, you will have acquired a solid and detailed understanding of the field of deep learning. I hope you will have learned how to design deep neural networks for a wide range of probabilistic inference tasks, and also you will have learned and practiced how to train them. Also, you will see that these models, they apply to a wide variety of artificial intelligence problems with really plenty of applications in the domains of engineering and in many scientific disciplines. And so I think some of you are doing, I know that some of you contacted me, they are starting a PhD and they are interested in learning about deep learning because that might be useful for their own research. So I hope you will learn that also in the course. All right, so let's dive in. So the first question that I will ask is, why do we want to learn? Why do we care about learning? And I will start with this set of pictures. And I will ask you the question, what do you see? So usually I do that in the classroom so I can see you. But please tell me what you see in the chat. Should not be too difficult. There is no trick. It's not a trick question. So you see mushrooms. Thanks. The question then I would ask you is, how do you do that? How do you know these are mushrooms? Because I'm quite sure none of you, almost none of you, are expert in mushrooms, even though you are all able to identify that in all of these images, they are mushrooms, even though they might be of many different colors and shapes. You can all tell me that these little things there are the mushrooms and not what is in the background, that this kind of white thing is a mushroom and not the background, that this thing in green is also a mushroom, and so on and so on. So the question that we may ask yourself is, how are we able to do that? And this is something new. You have not seen this mushroom before. Let's consider another example. This set of images. So in these images, there are dogs and there are also mops. Can you see them? So it's not too difficult. You should really quickly recognize that this is a dog, this is a dog, this is a dog, but this is not a dog. And this one is actually also a dog. And again, we are able to do that, to solve this task. Very quickly, it's very natural for us to do so, even though these two sets of objects, or and when I say object, it's a general term, of course, animals are not objects, or the two sets of concepts are quite different, but at the same time, they are represented in very similar fashion, The picture really looks the same. And still, we are able to detect what makes them different from one another. Same exercise. Again, there are dogs and there are muffins in these images. Can you spot them? So this is a dog. These are three dogs. And these, of course, are muffins. This one also is a muffin. And this is a dog. So I picked these examples, which, by the way, are not mine. So all credits should go to Karen Zack. But I think they are quite nice because what happens is that the human brain is so good at interpreting visual information that the gap between raw data and so the pixels of the images and its semantic representation about the content of the image, like the fact there is a mushroom in this bunch of pixels, is something which is difficult to assess intuitively. So again, if I show you this small image, you can all tell me very quickly, without even have to think about it, that this is a mushroom, that this image represents a mushroom. The same if I show you a larger version of the same image. Now you see, you're starting the pixels and you recognize that, okay, this is the pixelated representation of something, but you are still able to tell me that this something is a mushroom. But on a computer, an image is not represented, is actually represented in three parts, usually. So with three different channels, one for the red color, the other one for the green color, and then a third channel for the blue color. And so what you actually see on the screen is some kind of superposition of these three colors, and your eye is directly able to interpret this superposition as a color. Okay, even though if you could zoom in directly on the cells of your screen, you would actually see three different cells, at least for maybe it's not like this again in modern screens, but a few years ago it was still like this. You had for each pixels, you have actually three light cells, one for the red, one for the green, and one for the blue. And depending on their intensity, the colors of these three light cells would merge together. You would perceive them as a single color. And when it actually comes to store this image in a computer, this is the kind of thing the computer would have to deal with. And this is still a mushroom. Right? It's the same image, except that now we have represented the pixels by their numerical intensity. Right? But all this representation, they are strictly equivalent. Right? They represent the same content. This is an image of a mushroom. Right? And the reason I'm telling you this is that what would you do if you had to write a computer program that should be able to see, right? And this is now quite difficult because the computer program would be given this kind of information. And for us, we are not able, the mushroom is there, even though you cannot see it, but this is the kind of input we would have to start with. And so then the issue is that since we would not ourselves be able to write, since we are not able make sense of these numerical values ourselves, how could we write a program that would be able to do it? Right? If ourselves we are not even able to express how we are able to detect that there is a mushroom in this image, right? Even though we can do it, we cannot express how we do it. And so it becomes very difficult then if you have to implement a program that should do the same, that should try to reproduce and see. Okay, so how would you do it? How would you write a computer program that sees? And so the tasks, and so feel free to put your ideas in the chat. I'm quite interested in how you do that. Let's say that would be your project. This is the statement, and the goal would be to write a computer program that takes as input an image and then tells as output what's the content of the image. That there is, for example, a mushroom or there is no mushroom in the input image. How would you do it? So you are now in a following the master program. You've had at least 3 years, if not more, of programming experience. So you know how to write computer programs, but how would you write this one? Any ideas, suggestions? So there is a very first suggestion by Victor using KNN train with the labeled data. Okay. Or CNN. Yes. But Victor, you have not yet followed this course, so you cannot do that yet. Okay, there is another suggestion about using a convolutional neural networks. How would you do it without deep learning? That's my question. No one. Okay, so there is an interesting suggestion by WIS21, so which would be to compare picture with a huge database of pictures. And indeed, that's something you could do. Except we would have to define what we mean exactly by compare. And that's where the difficulty would arise. Another suggestion would be to compare pixel intensity to a data set we have, which is more or less the same. So I will tell you how it has been done for a few decades in computer vision. So let's say you are given the picture of a cat, like this one in the slides, and the goal is to write a computer program that should be able to tell whether or not there is a cat in this set of pixels, right? And so the common approach was to look for patterns and to state in advance what you should be looking for. So if you are looking for a cat, then you would use the knowledge that a cat is made of parts. It has a body and then 4 legs. It also has a head. And on this head, there are two ears, 2 eyes, a nose in the middle, and they are all connected to one another, right? And so you try to then write a program that would try to basically detect these patterns. So you would make some kind of pattern detectors for each one of these elements. And then you would try to recombine, and then you would also look if they are connected in a way which makes sense. So for example, if you find 2 eyes on the tails, and of course it does not make any sense. It's probably not a cat, maybe it is, but it's probably not. And then you would have a body. And then if all of these patterns, for example, are identified, then you would say your computer program would produce as an output that this is a cat, right? So this is the general approach which has been used before deep learning and in more traditional computer vision approaches. It worked to some extent. Of course, that also depends on the kind of things you want to detect, but it could work in some conditions reasonably well. However, the main issue with this kind of approach is that it's very, very brittle. It's very, very fragile because basically the real world is very messy and it's very difficult to anticipate for all possible conditions in which, for example, a cat may appear, right? So if I then show you this other second picture, this is still a cat, but the pattern detector would have a very difficult time to see that, oh, okay, this is a cat, because it's in such a position that it would be undetectable by this standard approach. And indeed, if you try to look for the cat, that would not work at all. So the issue is that basically extracting semantic information, so like concept, like there is a cat, requires models of very high complexity because you would need to anticipate for all these configurations. And this is typically something that would be quite difficult, if not impossible, to do by hand. So there is no way that you would be able to write a program by yourself in which you would have a priori encoded all these configurations. However, and this is really the philosophy of this course and in deep learning, or in machine learning actually in more generally, is that, and this may appear a bit surprising, but this is something we can do, even though we could not write a program to solve the task directly, what we can do in itself is to write a program that learns to solve the task of extracting semantic information. So that seems more complicated actually, but that's something we have now been able to do quite well, to write programs that are able to learn to solve a task that even though as humans we could solve it, we would not be able to describe how we do that. And actually there are even tasks that we cannot solve, but for which we can write programs that then are able to solve them better and much better than we can. And so the common approach which is used in practice, and this is really the philosophy when it comes to deep neural networks, is to define, to postulate a parametric model of high capacity. So in this case, the parametric model we'll talk about over and over in this course are neural networks. And they will have high capacity, and that by that I mean that they will be able to represent almost any function. So you start with this class or this parametric model, and then the second step will be to optimize its parameters. So you will see that neural networks come with thousands, tens of thousands, or these days even millions or billions of parameters. And I'm not joking, there are really now neural networks made of billions of parameters. And then the trick is to optimize the parameters of this model by making them work on the training data. And so you will keep adjusting all the parameters, all the knobs, in a sense, of the neural network until it makes predictions which agree with the training data that you have. Okay? This is what happens when we say that we have to train or to fit the neural network. So, before I tell you more about deep learning myself today and then in the remaining lectures in the following weeks, I want to start with this video. So it's a, I'm sorry if some of you are not speaking French, but I think it's a good one. It's a video by Yann Lequin, who is telling a bit about the story of deep learning and its own experience as a researcher who started working on deep learning 30 years ago and really has pushed and made several important contributions, fundamental contributions to make this work. So it will tell you about deep learning, what it is, and a bit of the story behind. And then I will move on to a few applications and successes. So things that you can do now with deep learning.
En fait, nous voyait comme des rêveurs pas très réalistes. Je suis Yann Lequin et je suis connu pour avoir grandement contribué à ce qu'on appelle le deep learning. Si vous retirez le deep learning de Facebook, Amazon ou Google aujourd'hui, les compagnies s'écroulent. Le deep learning est une branche de l'intelligence artificielle utilisée dans tous les systèmes de reconnaissance d'images, reconnaissance de la parole, compréhension de texte aujourd'hui. Ce qui m'intéressait là-dedans à l'époque, c'était l'idée de s'inspirer un petit peu du type d'apprentissage qu'on peut observer chez les animaux et les humains. On ne sait pas écrire un programme directement qui permettrait à une machine de reconnaître un chat d'une voiture, d'une table, d'une chaise. Donc pour ça, il faut se reposer sur l'apprentissage et les réseaux de neurones artificiels, en particulier les réseaux convolutifs, qui sont un peu mon invention. Donc je vais vous raconter un petit peu comment ça s'est passé. Ça a pris une trentaine d'années. J'avais 20 ans, donc j'étais en deuxième ou troisième année d'école d'ingénieur. Et j'avais jamais entendu parler de ça avant. J'ai trouvé ça fascinant. Et je me suis aperçu qu'il y avait eu beaucoup de publications entre les années 50 et la fin des années 60, et puis après, plus rien. Il y avait très peu de travaux sur le domaine dans l'informatique à l'époque. Je voulais vraiment faire de la recherche. Je ne savais pas comment m'y prendre, mais c'est vraiment ce qui me passionnait. Donc je commence mon doctorat en 83, et aux alentours de 83, justement, Terry Sosnowski et Jeffrey Hinton publient un article qui passe inaperçu, mais qui pour moi était vraiment important, qui en fait lève la limitation qui avait conduit les chercheurs dans les années 60 à abandonner les réseaux neurones artificiels. Ça s'appelle les réseaux neurones artificiels parce qu'en fait ces systèmes sont des espèces de simulations numériques de réseaux de neurones qui sont interconnectés les unes avec les autres. Quand on construit un réseau de neurones, on connecte les neurones les uns avec les autres et on peut avoir des réseaux de neurones qui ont une couche ou deux couches, ce qu'on faisait dans les années 60, ou plusieurs couches. Et la grosse question, c'est comment on entraîne un système qui a plusieurs couches. Et en fait, j'ai trouvé une méthode pour faire ça. Jeffrey Hinton, avec ses collègues, on a découvert une version un petit peu améliorée, donc qu'on appelle la rétropropagation de gradient. Et c'est cette méthode-là, en fait, qui a fait démarrer le domaine des réseaux neurones artificiels à la fin des années 80. Je pars au Canada, dans le laboratoire de Jeffrey Hinton. Et là, je fais une autre trouvaille qu'on a appelé les réseaux convolutifs par la suite. Je suis resté juste un an parce que j'ai été recruté par Bell Labs, qui se focalisait entièrement sur la recherche sur les réseaux neurones artificiels. Vous comprenez que Bell Labs, à l'époque, c'est un endroit mythique. C'est là qu'ont été inventés le transistor, le laser, les cellules solaires, les caméras CCD, le système Unix, le langage C et C++. Si on vous offre un job à Bell Labs, vous ne pouvez pas refuser. Donc j'y suis allé avec l'idée d'y rester un an ou deux et puis de retourner en France. Et en fait, je suis aux États-Unis depuis 32 ans. Comme les gens se sont un petit peu désintéressés des réseaux de neurones au milieu des années 90, j'ai un peu changé de sujet. Je me suis intéressé à la compression d'images, des choses comme ça. Puis ensuite, je deviens professeur à l'Université de New York. Et là, je redémarre un programme de recherche intense dans le domaine de l'apprentissage automatique. Donc là, je me réunis avec Yoshua Bengio et Jeffrey Hinton et on démarre une espèce de complot pour essayer de raviver l'intérêt de la communauté pour ces méthodes de réseau neurone. Une certaine partie de la communauté, en fait, nous voyait comme des rêveurs pas très réalistes. On fait un rebranding un petit peu, on renomme le domaine des réseaux neurones Deep Learning, apprentissage profond. Mon ami Jeffrey Hinton, en 2012, a gagné une compétition qui s'appelait la compétition ImageNet. Il a utilisé un grand réseau neurone entraîné avec un peu plus d'un million d'images à classifier des images dans environ 1000 catégories différentes. L'amélioration des performances par rapport aux méthodes plus classiques était telle que la communauté de la vision par ordinateur s'est dit on ne pourra jamais rattraper ça avec les méthodes classiques. Donc ça a conduit à une espèce de révolution dans laquelle les gens du jour au lendemain en fait ont complètement changé leur méthode préférée. Et ça a beaucoup attiré l'attention de l'industrie. À partir de ce moment-là, des compagnies comme Google, Facebook, un peu plus tard Amazon, Baidu, etc. commencent à se dire on va vraiment pouvoir appliquer ça. Et donc elles se sont jetées dessus. Après la victoire d'ImageNet, après les progrès en connaissance de la parole, etc., il y a eu une explosion. C'est devenu une énorme communauté avec une industrie derrière, avec des postes de recherche dans le monde académique, dans la recherche publique. Ce qui m'intéresse, effectivement, c'est le mystère de l'intelligence d'une manière générale, pas seulement l'intelligence des machines, et donc le mystère de l'apprentissage. On a encore beaucoup de progrès à faire, on est encore très très loin, en fait, de pouvoir reproduire les mécanismes d'apprentissage et certainement d'intelligence qu'on observe chez les animaux et les humains. Les machines les plus intelligentes aujourd'hui ont moins de bon sens qu'un chat gouttière. Il y a eu des hauts et des bas, hein. Une certaine partie de la communauté.
Right, so after this short introduction by Ian Luca himself, I want to just go through a few applications and successes of deep learning. So things we can do quite well today. I think you can view that as some kind of inspiring implications. So things that we can do only since a few years and which we could not do before and which we can already do quite well now. Also, it's also to show you the breadth of the potential applications of deep learning. I will show you a few one, for example, that which apply to images, but also you will see that you can apply deep learning to many other different in many other different contexts, in many different disciplines. So something we can do quite well is this thing which we call object detection, which is given an image or a video like the one you see in here. What you want to do is to identify, to detect all the objects that appear in the scene. So the fact that there is a fridge, that there is a person, that this is a plant behind, this is the task of object detection. A second task, which is very common in vision, is the one of pose estimation, which is basically to identify all the body parts of a person. And a last task, which is shown here in the video, is segmentation, which is the task of being able to identify the class of every pixel in the image. And to say that this pixel that you see here corresponds to this person, but not to the person next to him, and so on and so on. And so this is something now we can do quite well. There are plenty of algorithms and different neural networks that you can use to do that, and we'll see some of them. Another very interesting application is deep reinforcement learning. Is deep reinforcement learning, which is a combination of classical reinforcement learning methods like U-learning with functional approximators like deep neural networks. And so this paper was really a breakthrough a few years ago in 2014. And so what you will see there is an agent that learns to play a video game. So in this case, the game of Breakout. Just jump here. And so at the start, the agent has no clue. It does not understand what are the consequences of its actions, but this is something it can discover through reinforcement learning algorithm. But the additional difficulty is that the agent is given as feedback or as percept, really the screen, so the bunch of pixels that you also see as a human if you were to play the game. And it has to make sense of these pixels or of the sequence of images in order to take action. So this is something we've been able to do already quite well for some time. So when it comes to observations that are represented just by a few features, but when the observations are images like this of much higher dimensionality, then it's very difficult. But you can use deep neural networks to ingest and process these images and then combine them with reinforcement learning algorithm. So what is interesting there is that after some time, after some hours of training, the agent actually learned to play the game and to play it quite well. But also, as you saw at the end there, it also learned, and this was not really expected, it also learned a strategy, which is to basically, in this case, dig some tunnel and then to try to kick the ball into this tunnel such that it keeps bouncing on the bricks and on the top, on the ceiling of the environment, so that it would win and earn many points without taking any risk. And so, of course, this was a simple video game. Now there has been quite a lot of research on other video games that are increasingly complex, increasingly complicated. One of them is, for example, the game of StarCraft II. And so this is some demonstration by DeepMind and their AlphaStar agent, which is defined as a combination of quite a few different neural networks, which look at the map or different parts of the maps, and then has to decide on the action it should take. With the difficulty here is that the environment is only partially observable. You do not see what the other player is doing. You do not see the entire map. And the action space is quite large because you have to decide. So in this game, you have different units and different buildings. And for each of them, you can do different actions. And so this is something you have to decide. So simply the number of actions that you can do at any time step is very large. And second difficulty is that you have to decide on an action at a rate of something like 30 or 60 or 100 actions per second. And that's quite a lot, or per minute. Yeah, per minute. Yeah. But this is something now we are able to also do using deep neural networks. And this agent AlphaStar is as good as the very best player for the game. Another nice application is the one of autonomous cars. So this is a video that I've already shown you if you followed my previous class on AI. but of course, now there is a lot of research going on in trying to make cars drive themselves. So this is something which is done, for example, by NVIDIA, Tesla, and other companies. And this is something which we can do quite well already. So this is a video from 2016, so 4 or 5 years ago. So quite old when it comes to deep learning. But already at the time, it led to quite, in my opinion, impressive results. And there, in this case, the car also has to learn to drive.
Holy cow!
Whoa, so at the beginning is not very good.
Whoops! Wrong way!
But after a few miles of training, a few thousands of miles of training, so the difficulty, so where are the neural networks there in this kind of systems? Well, if you see the car, it's equipped with a bunch of different cameras of different types. And you have to make sense of these images in order, for example, to rebuild, to have a view of the environment around the car. And then once you have this perception of the environment, you can then decide on some action to go forward, to brake, to go right, to go left, let's say, simplify. And so what you should understand, it's really not just a single neural network doing the whole job. It's a composition of different neural networks. For example, you would have one for processing the input of the first camera, another for the second camera, and so on. And then you would combine them all. And for example, you would feed the output of all these, I would say, frontline neural networks to another that maybe would have to decide on the next action, and so on and so on. Another video of self-driving car is the autopilot from Tesla, so from 2 years ago. And you see that now I think it's quite impressive. So this is a 2 minutes accelerated video of the car driving in real conditions. This is not in a parking lot like in the previous video. These are real world conditions in California. The car is taking the highway. You see that the quote driver is never touching the, how do you call that? Le volant in French, but sorry, this is a word I do not know in English. But so the car is really self-driving from the start of the journey until the end, and the driver has really become just the passenger. Okay, and again, so there are very few details, technical details that have been released by Tesla about how the autopilot works, but there, a few of them have appeared, and it was it's known that it's fully based on deep learning, and there are more or less in the order of 50 or 100 different neural networks that compose autopilot to make sense of the data, different kind of images, as I said, of the different cameras or sensors, and then also to combine them all together. So you, for example, you may have neural networks that would be specialized, for example, in learning to identify the lanes, the white lines, other to identify objects, like other cars around the car, or persons, and so on and so on. And then others that then would combine all this information together to decide on the next action. Also, what is quite unique when it comes to Tesla is that they have a huge data set of driving, because all the Teslas are recording where they drive and in which conditions, and all this data is sent back to Tesla. So if you have a Tesla, then you are contributing to the data set, and that then this information will be used to improve autopilot, which will then percolate to all the other cars, because they will all contribute together to increase the data set and make the system better. Okay, so this was for self-driving cars. Another field of applications which I like to talk about is using AI or deep learning for scientific discoveries or in scientific disciplines. And so this is quite different application from everything we've seen before. But what you see there is a neural network which has learned physics. And so the ground truth is shown on the right, on the left, and the predictions of the neural network is shown on the right. And the way you do that is that you can have a neural network that is structured as a particle system, so as a graph of particles, and then it can model the interactions of particles, of pairs of particles, in order to, for example, capture and model the dynamics of fluids, or things like this. And this is So this is something you can do already quite well using just our own scientific knowledge, and that's a whole field in itself, fluid dynamics, for example. But the reason we want to do that, for example, with deep learning, is that you could achieve the same result, more or less, but using much less computation. Because if you want to simulate with high fidelity this kind of ground truth, that will take you hours, if not days. But on the other hand, if you are using a neural network, once it is trained, it's very fast, and you would have that result, which looks very good in my opinion, but you could argue it's not perfect, but you would have this result in a matter of seconds or less. Another example of AI or deep learning used in science is the very recent breakthrough of AlphaFold. So I will not show you the video, but if you're curious, I really invite you to watch it. And it's a bit of the story behind how deep learning has been used to crack the problem of protein folding. And so exactly as what happened, for example, with ImageNet and the huge improvement that happened when researchers switched to deep learning. This is what happened also recently for protein folding. So DeepMind has been able to really make a huge improvement using a method based on deep learning. And they've now reached performance which goes much beyond what was expected to happen during the next years. So this is very exciting in my opinion. Of course, you can use deep learning for technological applications, but also to advance science, and I think this is quite important. Another application is more concrete, is the use of neural network for speech synthesis and question answering. So this is, I think, an impressive, but also at the same time, it always makes me a bit uncomfortable. So now, if you have a smartphone on Android or even on an iPhone, they are you can talk to them, and when you talk to them, you are actually talking to a neural network, and you can have maybe not a conversation, but you can ask questions, and they understand your questions, and then they produce usually sensible answers. It's far from perfect, but this is something we have made on which we've made huge progress. And so in this video, what you will see is a neural network making a phone call to to hair salon to make an appointment. Of course, this is something we cannot do today because of the lockdown. But if you could do that, you could ask the network to call the salon for you. So let's see.
As I said earlier, we think AI can help with this problem. So let's go back to this example. Let's say you want to ask Google to make you a haircut appointment on Tuesday between 10 and noon. What happens is the Google Assistant makes the call seamlessly in the background for you. So what you're going to hear is the Google Assistant actually calling a real salon to schedule the appointment for you. Let's listen.
Hi, I'm calling to book a woman's haircut for a client. I'm looking for something on May 3rd.
Sure, give me 1 second.
Mm-hmm.
Sure, what time are you looking for around?
At 12 p.m.
We do not have a 12 p.m. available. The closest we have to that is a 1:15.
Do you have anything between 10 a.m. and 12 p.m.?
Depending on what service she would like, what service is she looking for?
Just a woman's haircut for now.
Okay, we have a 10 o'clock.
10 a.m. is fine.
Okay, what's her first name?
The first name is Lisa.
Okay, perfect. So I will see Lisa at 10 o'clock on May 3rd.
Okay, great. Thanks.
Great. Have a great day. Bye.
So this was 2018, so 2 years ago. And so I like this example because you may think talking to a machine is something which will only happen in the future. I would say this is the past now. This is something we can do now, today, and which you can do using deep learning. Of course, then many ethical questions arise very quickly with this kind of technology, and I think you should be aware of them and always keep that in mind. For example, this person, she was not aware she was talking to a machine, and she did not, I'm quite sure, even would have thought or imagined that she was not talking to a real person, because the neural network in this case was impersonating so well a real person that it felt very natural. Of course, to reach this kind of result, it's not easy. There is a lot of engineering that need to happen to reach this kind of nice results. You will see by yourself that it's not that easy. It looks easy, but it takes sometimes a huge effort to train a neural network properly. And it can also quickly fail. So this is something which is not shown on the video, but I'm quite sure if the real person was started asking questions outside of the scope of taking an appointment, I'm not sure what would have been the result, because in this case, it's almost certain that the network was really trained in this kind of well-contained scope. Like, I want to take an appointment, maybe only for an hair salon. So there is a very limited number of interactions that can happen. But if you started to go outside of that, who knows what would have happened. Okay, so there are other applications that you can find in, for example, in art or in movies, in media. So things like copying the style of some paintings and then apply that directly to have some special effects is something you can do quite well now with deep learning. If you take now today pictures with your smartphone and then you want to apply a filter to make it look prettier, it's very likely that today the kind of filters that you would use are actually implemented by neural networks. Just to make it look better, for example, in Google Photo, there is a magic button just to make the photo look better. And this is all based on neural networks. Another thing you can do is to generate data. So this is something we'll do in lecture 9 and 10 when we talk about generative models. And so this is also 2 years ago, we've made progress since then. So what you will see is pictures of people, except that these people do not exist. They are just a byproduct of, let's say, the imagination of the neural network. They've been purely generated by a neural network. And so this is the kind of result we can achieve today as well. So. So, I mean, if I didn't tell you that these people were not real people, I'm quite sure you would not have guessed that they do not exist, because these results are very photorealistic. Unfortunately, one of the only applications of this technology are deepfakes. So you can use these kind of tools to impersonate other person or just to create these images. And so unfortunately, more and more you would see these kind of pictures in fake accounts on social media, on Facebook, Twitter. So they would look like real person, but actually they are not. And there is one easy way to detect them, is that usually the faces themselves, they would look fine. You could look closely, maybe there are issues with the symmetries of the eyes or the ears, but usually what they do not capture very well is the background. And when you close it, usually the background is blurry and is not photorealistic. It does not make sense. And you see there examples, for example, on this lady there, the background does not really makes much sense, this one and neither. And so this is something usually you can spot very quickly if you encounter fake accounts on social media. I think it's a good way to detect them. But we'll talk about that much later in the course. So you can generate images, you can also generate sound. So this is another example to generate music. And so what you will hear in this video is it's a partition which has been generated by a generative neural network and which is then played by a real orchestra. So again, this is just something which is the output of neural network. Of course, it was trained on real data, on real partitions that were written by real persons. But I think it's quite good. Of course, I'm no musician. I would not argue if you say this is nowhere close to Beethoven or any other famous composer. But at the same time, I think it's at least as good as the average human composer. And that I think we can all agree with. It's not maybe a masterpiece, but you can listen to it and maybe enjoy it even. All right, and then there is this final application that I want to show you today. I think it's quite, it's a very nice application of what you can do also with generative models. So it's an application of neural networks in a museum of DALL-E, where they've used neural networks to basically have a virtual avatar of DALL-E that would then welcome the visitor, but also interact with them. So I think it's a much better application than the deepfakes or this hairdresser appointment case. It's really to try to have an interaction with real people, but at the same time, these people, they do know quite well that they are talking to a machine because DALL-E is dead and it could not interact with them through a screen. So I will let you watch the video. It goes. So they will tell you about the context, but also they will give you a bit of details about how and when these neural networks are used for this application.
Greetings. I am Salvador Felipe Jacinto DALL-E y Domenech, and I am back.
Even though DALL-E's been gone for 30 years, we're using artificial intelligence to bring him back today. In order to actually train this AI to reproduce DALL-E's likeness, we've started with finding the right footage of DALL-E, and then we split that up into frames where he's looking the right way, and we pick the best frames to use for training from that. Our system learns exactly what he looks like and how his mouth moves and how his eyes move and his eyebrows and every little detail about what makes DALL-E DALL-E.
This is actually a recreated version of DALL-E. It's not a person playing DALL-E with makeup. It is actually DALL-E. We're very careful to use his words so that you learn a lot about what he thought and the way he thought.
People want access to art. They want a way in. It can be through technology, through learning about the artist.
Greetings. Welcome.
This technology allows people to imagine for a moment that there is such a thing as immortality, to see DALL-E alive again.
The whole future of DALL-E is explained in Le Brother painting.
I saw DALL-E, but like his actual form, full figure, speaking personally to me.
He was welcoming into the museum to see his art, and like I still have goosebumps.
It is good to be back.
He talked about the museum and his paintings.
There comes a moment in every person's life when they realize they adore DALL-E.
In your life, this moment will also be known as Wednesday. Go tell it to your friends.
Mr. DALL-E, very life.
Before you leave, you will take a picture with me?
Sure. Yeah.
Alors. Uno. Dos. Tres. Ooh la la. Would you like me to send you this dream photograph? Follow the instructions.
What that adds is a sense of emotion. If they can empathize with this man as a human being, then they can relate to the work much more directly, much more passionately.
To understand the art, you need to understand the artists behind the art. And this technique allows visitors of the Dalí Museum to do just that.
I do not believe in my death. Do you?
All right, so I hope that this selection of mine about applications of deep learning got your interest. So you see that there are plenty of applications in various domains, from engineering and very technological applications in car, for example, but also in science and in art and many other disciplines. So pick the one you prefer, I think, for the project, for example. But also, I think this is one of the messages of this course. It's really for you to understand that this technology that we'll learn together, deep learning, can be applied in various contexts. It's not limited to computer science applications, I would say, but it really can be used in many other disciplines. And actually, it's revolutionizing many scientific disciplines. So, for example, it's used increasingly in physics, in chemistry also, in many domains of engineering. Many of them are doing research using deep learning now. And also all applications like social media and so on, they are using deep learning. So it's getting really, it's like an invasion or revolution. You will see deep learning more and more with time. And so because of that, because of really this obvious success of deep learning that happened really within just a few years. So recently, 2 years ago, the Turing Award was given to Joshua Bengio, Geoffrey Hinton, and Yann LeCun. So Yann LeCun that you saw in the video. So the Turing Award is really the Nobel Prize of Computer Science. So it's the highest award that you can earn as a computer scientist. And so it's really, I think, a recognition of the importance of deep learning for computer science in computer science. And so they got this award for conceptual engineering breakthroughs that have made deep neural networks a critical component of computing. And I think this is really true and will be confirmed even more within the next years. And so this is all to say, I think you made a good decision by selecting this course. I think this is an important topic to learn about because it will become essential, if not already, for many in technology and in science. All right, but still you may ask yourself, why does it work only now? Actually, when you look back, we were already talking about neural networks in the 80s or even in the 60s. But it's only now, since a few years ago, that we keep learning and hearing about deep learning. And so this is due actually to a few elements, a few breakthroughs that were needed in order to enable really, the kind of progress we have seen in this kind of applications. The first element is that we actually needed new algorithms, or actually critical improvement to previous algorithms, that without which it's actually not possible to train these deep neural networks with so many parameters. The second reason is that it's only now also with the rise of the web that we have enough data to train this kind of models. And so you will see that if you just have, for example, a couple of images, then unfortunately, it's still very difficult for a neural network to learn, for example, the concept of a cat from just a couple of images. On the other hand, if you show the networks millions of images of a cat, then it can do a good job with that. Then, of course, there are more practical reasons. One of them is software. So now it's very easy, and you will see that in the programming projects and in the homework, to set up a neural network and then train it, and to train it, for example, directly on your GPU, if you have one, or on several GPUs. So before, it was really an obstacle. If you wanted to make it work, let's say 10 years ago, then you had to write everything from scratch yourself. So that would just, I mean, quite a difficult task by itself. And then you would still have to train this neural network. And then finally, the last reason I would highlight is the fact that the hardware has improved by a lot as well. And so these days, you have very fast compute engines. For example, using GPUs that were originally made for video games, they are now used a lot for deep learning purposes. There are also dedicated hardware that you can find, like TPUs, Tensor Process Unit, that actually have been made for the only purpose of training deep learning networks. And this is, for example, what is done at Google. They have their own hardware, and so which they have designed and built in-house, which was made only for that purpose. So it's even better than GPUs. All right. Still, and this is also something I want to emphasize, even though deep learning is very recent and exciting, it's does not come out of nothing. It actually builds on 5 decades of research in more traditional machine learning or statistical learning. And so this huge body of research that you have in machine learning is really important also for deep learning, because it has provided basically a good understanding, a good taxonomy of the machine learning concepts. So what do we mean formally by when we talk about classification, generative models, clustering, kernels, linear embeddings? All these things we know how to formulate quite well and precisely, and we understand them well from a theoretical point of view. Also, a sound statistical formalization, for example, Bayesian estimation, pack learning, these kind of things are quite also important for deep learning. The research in machine learning has also provided a clear picture of fundamental issues that remain true for deep learning, like the bias variance dilemma, VC dimensions, generalizations, and all these things. A good understanding of optimization issues. And finally, research in machine learning has also provided efficient large-scale learning algorithms. So deep learning is really building upon that as well. So please do not forget anything that you've seen in introduction to machine learning. This remains quite important. We'll just be building upon that. So deep learning itself, from a practical perspective, what I would like to say is that it will lessen the need for a deep mathematical grasp, and instead it will make the design of a model, of a deep neural network, more like a software or system development task. Okay, so you don't, by that I mean you can really view that as a from a hacker perspective or more a practical perspective. Even if you do not understand all the mathematical details, you can view that from some kind of, a software development task where you are given modules, building blocks that you can combine together in order to solve a task. Okay, and this is really more akin to what you do in software engineering. Also, deep learning makes it very easy to leverage modern hardware, so GPUs. Now, all software libraries in deep learning, they allow you to do that without having to change or to do anything special in your code. So this is very nice. This is really operating at a level of abstraction, which is much above hardware considerations. which means that the development time usually is usually quite fast. Another interesting fact is that deep learning will not plateau when using more data. So the more data you have, the better. And that's always, almost always true. And also it makes large trained neural networks a commodity. By that I mean, training a big neural network by itself is something you can do, but it's still difficult. But what's new is that now you can also find on the internet neural network that is already pre-trained on some tasks, for example, on ImageNet, on images. And you can download this network as some kind of artifact and then use it either to continue the learning or just as another building block for your application. So this is why now these large trained neural networks have really become a commodity. Finally, I will conclude this first part with this quote from Chris Bishop, who said the following in his keynote at New RIPS in last December. And he said, for the last 40 years, we programmed computers. For the next 40 years, we will train them. And I think this is really the philosophy that you should have when it comes to deep learning. It's really a change of paradigm. So even yourself, for 3 or 4 years, you've been learned how to program computers. And now in this course, you will learn how to instead train computers. And I think this is true. This is something which is happening more and more, at least, for example, at big companies. Many core parts, for example, at Google, are replaced by neural networks. Of course, there is still software around this neural network that you need to write. But it's more acting like the glue, as some glue, rather than the brain of the system. The brain now increasingly is made of neural networks that you train. All right, so do you have questions? So we'll do a break in just a few minutes, but if some of you have questions now, I would be happy to answer them.